introduce Melanie Moore. She is going to be talking about hospice care, and those are all.
Thank you very much. I appreciate the opportunity to present to you today. I also want to be sure to let you know that Betsy Payne is here. She is also a part of our Doylestown Hospital hospice team. So I appreciate her help and her support this morning as well. I wanted to start out by telling you a little bit of history about hospice. It's less than 50 years old, the whole movement. It was started in 1967 in England, which is now the famous St. Christopher's Hospice House in Sydenham. And it came to America around to the United States about 1974 in New Haven, Connecticut. So that's just a little piece of history about hospice. It's relatively new. So I think that's part of the reason why there's some misunderstanding and some misconceptions about hospice care, is it hasn't been around quite long enough to have a clear philosophy in this country. So hopefully today, we'll be able to help you understand and consider hospice. It's very, very important to consider hospice care before you need it, because it's not a crisis-driven decision. It often is a crisis-driven decision, unfortunately, but what we want to do is help you to understand hospice so that you have in your mind decisions that you might want to make for yourself or your loved ones when the time comes for those decisions. Many of us think we know what hospice is, and we have ideas about what hospice is, but I'd like to begin today by saying what hospice is not. So, thank you, Betsy. Enter, maybe. There we go. Hospice is not giving up. It is not losing hope or stopping everything. It is not quitting or losing the battle. It is not just letting someone die. It is not that. And it is not doing nothing. So often we've heard these terms used when someone goes on hospice. So I want to make it very clear that that is not correct. The actual definition of hospice is at the very center core of this philosophy is the belief that each of us has the right to die pain-free and with dignity, and that our families have also the right to receive the necessary support to allow us to do so. When you consider hospice care, what is some most of the ideas that you really have to remember are, unfortunately, the realities of life. The reality of living is that we're going to die. And often in our society, that's not something we want to think about, and it's certainly not something we want to talk about. But even with continued medical advancement, even with all the treatments, all the diagnostic tests, all the many ways that medicine can help us, our bodies still do not live forever. And also, even when we're going through medical treatments, our bodies don't always respond the way that physicians or the way that we or our families would hope. The other thing is that just natural progression of age or chronic illness is often, you know, the reasons that we're considering hospice care. So it may be one of the diagnoses that we often use for the elderly, because it just happens, is adult failure to thrive, meaning you get to a certain age and your body is just tired. When you think about hospice and you get to a certain point and you realize that medical care, medical treatments are just not working, then it's time to really think about your priority. And for many people, the priority at that time is quality of life rather than working so hard to stay alive. But in order for that to happen, there has to be an acceptance or a focus away from medical and towards the memorable. And the reason I like to say that is because for many of our hospice families, the way it's often stated to us is, you know what, we don't want to try to get to the doctor's office and sit in the waiting room or have Dad lie supine in an MRI machine or a CT scan anymore. Dad's tired of being poked and prodded and tested, and he's tired of going in for all the treatments. He's ready to stay home, and he's ready to spend the time with us and with his friends. So all of a sudden, the focus shifts from going to have medical treatment and curative treatment to having quality of life in a way that supports memories and just more family or friend time, what we like to call really quality time at the end of life. How does hospice care work? Family members serve as the primary caregiver. At Doylestown Hospital Hospice, 75% of our hospice care occurs in the home. And what we found is that 99% of people want to die where? At home, absolutely. Most people want to die at home surrounded by their loved ones and their friends. So that's what our hospice care is all about. We teach and educate and support family members to be the primary caregiver. Members of the hospice staff make regular visits to assess the patient and provide additional care and or other services, and we'll talk about that as well. Hospice staff are on call 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. So if you've got a family member who just says, I don't know what to do, I am overwhelmed, there's always someone available to help. So that's one of the best things about hospice care. Who decides how to care for the patient or the loved one? The hospice team develops a care plan or a plan of care that's individualized for each and every patient that it cares for. But the patient and the primary caregivers or the family or friends or whomever the significant others are in that person's life, they are the main part of the team. We had a hospice nurse who always used to come in and say, I work for you. I'm here to have you steer the ship. You're in charge. You're the captain. This is your journey. I'm just on the boat with you. So what you need to understand is that I'm going to help you as you go through this journey and your family. So the team, the hospice team, consists of the patient and caregiver, the patient's personal physician. It's important for you to understand you can keep your doctor. You know, most of the doctors at Doylestown are very, very honored to continue to be your physician while you're on hospice care. They're certainly capable. So we are very fortunate in this community to have physicians who are willing and eager to help you as you go through your hospice journey. Hospice physician and medical director is also available. Dr. Veronica Coyne, many of you probably know her. She is our hospice medical director. She is available 24/7. She's awesome. So if we have a question or a physician has a question, she's always available to help and to be supportive. You have hospice nurses who are always RNs, home health aides who come into the home to provide some personal care, social workers. And I'd like to say social workers are available to help you find other resources if your family's having difficulty or feeling overwhelmed to help you with your personal care at home. Their goal is to enable you to stay in the place that you wish to die. So a social worker is extremely important. Clergy or other counselors, and I'm sure you can understand why that's important. Trained volunteers, the heart of our hospice program are our volunteers. We have, I think at this point, 65 volunteers. They go through significant amount of training. They're not just people who say, I'd like to go sit with the patient. They go through about 120 hours of training in order to be qualified to be a hospice volunteer. Our volunteer coordinator is active in making sure our volunteers are supported, that that training continues, and that the volunteers have a good fit with the patient, because that's important too. You also can have therapies. I often say to people, they're surprised. They're like, oh, I can have physical therapy. Absolutely. We want the patient to stay, have the quality of life that they desire. So obviously, if they want to try to maintain strength and continue to maybe even increase strength, we have physical and occupational therapy and also speech therapy. So just because you're on hospice, it doesn't mean that all of that stops. The plan of care that I'm talking about is very, very descriptive. It's very individualized, but it is a plan that consists of the medical care, the medications, how many nursing visits we're going to have, and those can increase and decrease. The plan of care is always changing based on the patient's status and as the patient declines through the hospice experience. It talks, the plan of care even covers your equipment needs. It talks about whether you need a hospital bed, bedside commode, overbed table, those sorts of things. And by the way, those are covered 100% under the hospice benefit with Medicare and most insurances also. So equipment needs, medications that are pertinent to your hospice diagnosis and to your comfort and symptom management are covered 100% under the hospice benefit. Treatments needed to provide comfort. So we want to be sure it's not all medicine. Sometimes it's that, like I said, the therapy. We have pets that can come into the home. We have a hospice choir. We have a lot of different things that can help to kind of enhance the experience for everyone. Psychosocial support, spiritual support, and personal care needs of the patient are all outlined in the plan of care. This is my favorite screen. How to initiate hospice care. Well, to initiate it, you got to talk about it. And this is the most difficult part of hospice care. Our society has such a difficult time talking about it. We have a hard time talking about it with our families. Families have a hard time talking about it with patients. Doctors have a difficult time. But in order to get to the point where you are, and I'm going to just say it because it's part of talking about it, you're dying the way you choose to die, you have to talk about it. So, to initiate hospice care, it can happen several ways. I'm the hospice coordinator for Doylestown Hospital, so I often sit in my office, the phone will ring, I'll get a phone call. It's a daughter or a son or a husband or a wife or maybe even a friend. And they'll say, you know what? My mom, Jane, she is really not doing well. She's in the hospital right now and she's just not really responding to the treatments there. Can you tell me about hospice? When that happens, I obviously give her information over the phone about hospice, but I also say, how does your mom feel about hospice? Has your mom thought about that? Well, not really. And I said, well, you know what, maybe it's a good idea to talk to her about that. And then we have someone who can go out and really explain hospice, give reading materials, really go in depth about what the hospice care is going to look like just for your mom. And that's usually Betsy, who's going to go out and do what we call an introduction to hospice. We also are very, very sure that I always ask, can I speak to your primary physician about this? Because there's nothing worse than a primary physician getting a call saying mom's going on hospice. They should be a part of the decision, obviously. So usually the family member will say, absolutely, doctor, let's say Coyne is my family doctor, and I would really, you know, I'd like her to know about it. I pick up the phone, I call the physician, and they're like, oh, sometimes they're surprised. Sometimes they're like, oh, this is so great. Absolutely. I'm on board with this decision if the family and patient choose to go forward with this. Sometimes I get referrals directly from the doctor. I'll have doctor's offices call me and say, you know what? Mrs. Smith was in the office today, and she's just not doing well. We talked to them a little bit about end of life. Can you call them now? So a lot of times our referrals come directly from physicians. So then, like I said before, there's a visit to the family and the patient to explain hospice care. And we also have to assess the need for hospice, because just because a family member thinks that that patient's ready for hospice, they may not be. There are certain criteria that have to be met in order for someone to begin hospice care. And care usually begins once you're assessed and it is determined that you are appropriate for hospice. Care begins in a day or two of this process, or it can begin sooner if it's urgent. We don't like it to be urgent, because when it's urgent, you're not getting the benefit of the total package. Your family isn't getting all of the support that they could have. You're certainly not getting all the symptom management and support you could have as the patient. To be eligible for hospice services, your physician must attest, and this is a attestation, that you have 6 months or less to live. That's what they have to say. That doesn't mean that you have to die in 6 months. We don't like try to work it so you're going to be gone in 6 months. Trust me. What we do say is if your disease process or your natural progression of your chronic illness or your failure to thrive progresses at the rate that it is progressing today, the physician feels as though you have 6 months or less to live. Now, like I said before, If at the end of 6 months you're still with us and you're actually doing better, which sometimes happens, we have graduates of hospice, hard to believe, but people often get better on hospice. For one thing, I think their whole mental attitude changes. A lot of the medications that made them, I hate to say this, I hope there's no one in the room who's a doctor, not going to be upset, but a lot of the medications that they're taking are stopped. And quite frankly, they feel better. We have graduates of hospice pretty often, especially if it's a chronic illness and people stabilize. So we have to always be looking and assessing someone to see if they've plateaued or even if they're better to determine if they can continue hospice care. That being said, if after the end of 6 months you're still declining, you're still having symptom management, you're still in need of hospice, the benefit continues. There is no stop date. So we're going to always be continuing to look at you. So let's say at month 9 or 10, you're still declining and you need symptom management, you're staying on hospice. We're not just going to cut you. Yeah.
Somewhere I was told that Medicare would only pay for 6 months.
That is not true. Medicare will pay for the first 90 days. Medicare will pay for another 90 days. It's just that at the end of the 90 days and the next 90-day period, the assessment has to occur again. So the hospice team and the physician, we go back in, another attestation is signed, and then you continue on the Medicare benefit with hospice.
And that can continue then indefinitely?
It can continue indefinitely. I will say Medicare has become more rigid. Regulatory criteria has been a little bit more strict. We have actual diagnostic guidelines. So if you don't fall within those diagnostic guidelines and we see that you're stable, and we're not out there making changes, we're not adjusting medications or increasing care or increasing visits, then we need to look at whether or not you need to stay on hospice. What happens is that there are often, not everybody on hospice has cancer. Let's get that out there. You know, actually, probably only about 40% of our patients have cancer. Different diseases include COPD, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, Alzheimer's or different vascular dementias, cardiac, end-stage cardiac issues, like I said before, adult failure to thrive, renal patients who decide they have had it with dialysis, they're tired of being hooked up so many hours a day. Those people qualify for hospice. So there are lots of chronic diseases that allow you to qualify for hospice. And believe me, it is very, very difficult, obviously, to project whether you have 6 months or less to live. But physicians are very good about that. And they say, you know what, I don't know. No one has a crystal ball, but we want to be sure that, yes, this person does look terminal at this point, and they deserve hospice support. I love this slide because hospice care works best when there are months rather than days. I will tell you that our average length of stay at Doylestown Hospice is 21 days. That is way too short. We get referrals at the last minute. The reason I'm presenting today is because I want you to think about and consider hospice care so that when you're talking to your physician, before you actually even need it, you've got it in the back of your mind. You can go off hospice. If you decide that you want to have treatment during the middle of your hospice stay, you can actually revoke your hospice benefit and Medicare will pick you right back up. So just because you've signed on to hospice doesn't mean you can't get off. But it's so important that you understand that if you can get on hospice earlier, you get more support and more care and more help, and so does your family. Again, like we said before, there's no set limit to receiving hospice services once admitted to care. And hospice care, like we also said before, is not just for people with cancer. I want to talk about caregiving because that is obviously a huge, huge part of a hospice care. And like I said before, the primary caregivers for a patient on hospice is the family, significant other, friend. There's usually what we like to do is the patient designates one primary caregiver. And that primary caregiver coordinates and works with other supports within the family and the community and obviously with our help to provide care to the patient. We go out, we've had families say, gosh, you know, I can't take care of someone in bed all the time. There's just no way. I've never done it, don't want to do it. And if they can't get up and go to the bathroom by themselves, and I'm just going to say it out here, there is no way I am going to do that. That's what they usually start with. But what we do is teach families. First of all, we provide the equipment. So we're going to have a hospital bed out there. So you're not bending down over your, you know, double bed or king-size bed at your house trying to care for someone. A hospital bed makes it so much easier. It goes up and down. It's got side rails that they can hold on to as they're turning. We're going to teach you how to turn a patient in bed. It's not that hard. We're going to teach you how to reposition someone for comfort. We're going to teach you how to help with incontinence, because at the end of life, people are too weak to get out of bed, to use a bedside commode even. So we're going to help you with that. We're going to help you even by supplying the supplies for that. We teach you how to give the medications. We're going to help you even by filling some syringes with the morphine or products that we use to help someone be comfortable. We're going to go through a comfort kit that we provide that you're going to keep, and we're going to anticipate symptoms so that you don't call us at 2 a.m, although you certainly can, to say my loved one is having some trouble breathing. You know what? We're going to have the medications in the home, and you're going to be pre-taught and pre-supported. If you forget it and you're panicked and it's 2 a.m, you call. And trust me, a nurse will either come out right away or walk you through it on the phone, whichever, you know, is needed at the time. So we're going to be anticipating the needs, because we understand caregivers have never done this before. This is foreign soil, and it's scary and it's overwhelming, because the caregiver's not only dealing with their grief, they're often dealing with the frustration of the patient, the changes that are occurring in their loved one. So we understand it's such a vulnerable, vulnerable time, but it can also be an extremely sweet time. How many of you have cared for someone who's dying? Have any of you done that? I had the experience of doing so for my father, and I have to say it was a very, very sweet, sweet time. Almost all of our families, actually I would say again 99.9% of our families, at the end of the experience say, wow, I am so grateful I had that time to spend with my loved one, and I did it. I took care of them. They died where they wanted to die. They died with all of us around them. As hard as this is and as sad as I am, it was a sweet time. So you need to know that. It's when you go into it, you're just sort of, I call it shock and awe, like you just can't believe it. Not only do you have to deal with the fact that a loved one is terminal, now you're a full-time caregiver. So that's like a double whammy. But you should know that there are supports out there to help you so that you're not a 24/7 caregiver. We're going to talk about that as well. Hospice provides home health aides that are available. They come in and they help shower or give bed baths, help change the linens, also instruct and educate family members on what to do when they're not there. I'm going to be really honest with you. Our home health aides come for about an hour to an hour and a half a day, usually 3 to 5 times a week, because that's pretty much all that's really necessary. They will come every day if necessary. But again, it's usually for only about an hour to an hour and a half, because we're going to instruct and help families understand how to do that. If you have a crisis and you need someone to come over, like I said, we're available 24/7. But most of our goal is to help the family care for their loved one, and to do so with our support, not our 24-hour, you know, nursing services. So that's important to know. We always teach caregivers, you've got to take care of yourself in order to take care of your loved one. So that includes setting up schedules. We have, like I said, volunteers who come in and help as well. So we, the social workers and the hospice nurse, the entire team works with the caregiver to say, let's coordinate this, because it takes coordination. Let's figure out who's going to be where, when. So we help you with the schedule, and hospice is very capable, and we've got lots of experience in helping you do that. These are some frequently asked questions about hospice, and I put these up here because this is what I get asked every day. So I just thought I'd throw them out there to you. Can hospice care occur in a facility like a nursing home or assisted living? Absolutely. We take care of patients in every single nursing home in this community. We have contracts with nursing homes in this community so that we work with them. What that looks like is called what we call collaboration of care. You get the same amount of visits, you get the nurses, you get the social work, but we're also helping the nurses and the nurses' aides at the facility care for the patient. Our home health aides still go in. But what we want to do is be sure that, you know what, a lot of those patients have relationships with those nurses and those nurses' aides in the facility because they've lived there for a while and it's their home. So we're not only supporting the family and the patient, we're also supporting the nursing home staff. And that's very important to remember. How do I deal with the family member who does not agree with the hospice decision? I always say there's always a daughter or a cousin who flies in from Texas, and they haven't seen mom or dad in a while, and they're like, what do you mean you stopped treatment? What do you, they should go to the hospital. Are you kidding? He's bounced back before. Let's do it again. The family's all set. They've got hospice in place. Everyone's feeling good about the decision, and they're comfortable. And then you got a family member who disagrees. And that's okay, because that family member can disagree. But if you've talked about it and you feel supported in your decision, you should be able to also talk about it with a family member who doesn't agree. The priority is to honor the patient's wishes. And that may be more difficult. That usually is more difficult for the loved ones around that patient than obviously it is for the patient. So it's very clear. That's why we're talking about this today, so that you can make your wishes known. You can talk to your families and your friends, and you can let them know what, how you want to end your, how you want your life to end. Not that you're going to end your life, but how you want that journey to look. When do I call faraway family? This gets asked all the time. You know, I've got children who live in California. I don't want them to fly in and be here for 6 weeks because they have jobs, they have families. How do I know what to do? The hospice nurses will help you with that. I liken death to sometimes to like birth. There are stages of birth, and it's all individualized and different for every woman who goes through birth. All of you know that, but you still go through the stages of birth. Death is like that. There are stages that you go through as you're going through the dying processes, the dying process. Hospice nurses know those stages. So we don't have a crystal ball, and things can happen just like that, but we often can sense when death is approaching so that we can help the family decide when to call in faraway family. And again, will I be able to know exactly when my loved one will die? That is a big question. Everybody wants control. Everybody wants to know, you know, so they can plan. Sometimes that's, you know, easy, and sometimes it's not at all. Like we said before, we don't have a crystal ball, but we can help you understand the changes that occur physically at the end of life so that we can sort of read and guide you as you're getting there. Yeah.
Does Doylestown Hospital, Lakeview, or Pine Run have beds specifically for hospice?
That's a very good question. No. We have in Doylestown Hospital, we've been talking about an inpatient unit there. That would be an inpatient unit, though, meaning that it would be for acutely ill people in the hospital that are either imminent or their symptoms cannot be managed at home. Lakeview, we do not have specific beds there, although I will tell you that we have helped people be placed in Pine Run or Lakeview at the end of life if their families just simply can't care for them at home. So the answer to that is no, there are not specific beds, but yes, we will help you if that's what your family member wishes to do.
Gotcha. And there again, that's not an issue with Medicare?
Well, Medicare is not going to pay for room and board. Okay. Medicare is going to pay for hospice just like it would look in the home. So if you decide to go into a facility, you are responsible for room and board. We're going to still cover medications, equipment, our services. But it can be very expensive. We often tell families it is much more economical to hire help. 24-hour caregiving, and I'm going to put this out here, usually runs about $165 a day, Betsy, for a 24-hour period. And that's expensive. But when you're looking at a bed in a facility for over $200 or $250 even sometimes, it's a lot less expensive. And also, the one thing I will say with 24-hour caregiving, it sort of has a bad rap. You know, sometimes people are like, well, I don't want other people in my home, and I don't want people to be there to help me. But the truth is, there are some caregiving agencies out there that most of our patients really love, and we obviously can't determine who you're going to choose. We can't even sway you. But I will say, there are some agencies out there, and the patients develop amazing relationships with these caregivers. And most of the time, these caregivers understand hospice because that's what they do. If you're contacting that agency, they will give you a caregiver who's familiar with hospice, knows symptom management, knows when to call a hospice nurse, knows how to communicate to a family, knows how to provide that level of care. So, you know, it's an individual decision. It's a family's decision that they have to make based on what their needs are. But I would say there are some wonderful, wonderful supports out there with live-in care. Or even piecemeal care, so that they're there 4 hours a day, 8 hours a day, overnight, that sort of thing. Yes?
Coming back to that part, if somebody disagrees with the situation, there should be already set up a legal partner who is responsible. And you would go first of all to the patient, then, is that right?
That is correct.
And then to the legal person.
Correct. Correct. Absolutely. To the power, the durable power of attorney. I'm like having a total, yes, absolutely.
And that should be very well respected by people. So I'll just, you know. Here's one. Should I encourage my loved one to eat and drink? That is huge, because as you go through the dying process, people, especially Southern women, which I am, you got to always eat. How can you stop eating? So it's very difficult. It's like, oh my gosh, you know, they're not eating. I can't possibly let this happen, because if he doesn't eat, he'll die, you know? And honestly, that is a part of the dying process. If you really try to get someone to eat and they don't want to eat, it's more uncomfortable for them, because the body is not able to utilize that food source in a comfortable way. You can't digest as well. Your liver isn't working as well. Your kidneys aren't working as well. For drinking, what I will say, there's actually there are studies that have been done that show that dehydration for someone who's dying actually causes a euphoric and a symptom management side effect, and that you have less pain if you're a little dehydrated, which is fascinating to some people, but it's true. Artificial hydration and artificial nutrition are not encouraged at the end of life. What should I do when they can't swallow their pills anymore? How will they take their medications? Well, hospice has been doing this for quite a while, so there are all kinds of liquid medications that are highly concentrated, so they're literally a dropper in the cheek or under the tongue. There are gels that are wonderful, that are made up of a combination of medications or single meds that can just be rubbed on the skin. There are patches that people can wear to help control pain or other symptoms. So we've got other ways. You don't have to just swallow pills. Won't my loved one become dehydrated? We've answered that. How do I provide comfort during the dying process? At some point, the medications are obviously what you're going to give, but it's so, so important just to be there with that person. Gentle massage, we show you how to do that using lotions, giving mouth care, repositioning, making sure the person is dry, clean. We call it clean, comfortable, and dry, that's kind of our synopsis. Those are the most important things to help with comfort. And also, families often ask, can they still hear me? Because people often become, they usually do become very unresponsive at the end of life. We always say, please keep talking. Studies have shown that hearing is the last thing to go. Soft music, talking to your loved one. If you prefer reading the Bible or reading whatever literature you think will calm that person down or just help to keep them peaceful, all of those things. Having life stories. A lot of times life review is so wonderful and sweet, because you can do that at the end of life and the person really appreciates that. How will I understand the changes in my loved one? We help you with that. People sometimes have mental changes, cognitive changes, and often they get really worried about that. As disease progresses, there are physical and mental changes that do occur. But again, hospice is there to answer your questions. Oftentimes, family members say, well, I gave the morphine and all of a sudden they're really sleepy or they're not as clear. I don't want to give the morphine anymore. And what we say to people is the number one fear of dying is what? Does anyone know? The number one fear of dying?
Pain.
So a lot of times people will actually become very used to the morphine. They are acclimated to it, let's say. And so the morphine doesn't have the side effect of making them as lethargic or sleepy as they get more used to it. Usually within the first day or two of starting medications like that, there are side effects. But often people become more alert and actually more comfortable and more peaceful when they're given the pain medications. So hospice talks to you about that. They keep talking to you about that, and we want to be sure that we're giving pain medications like we should to help the person be comfortable. And I'm going to tell you a couple of little stories. We've had some family members who say, you know what though, my grandchild's flying in and I want daddy to be awake because I want daddy to see, you know, little Joey. And that is really, you know, an individual case by case, but often when you are trying to take someone off of pain medication, it's very difficult then to catch back up and to get them comfortable again. So again, we try to help you understand
when to bring in family members so that you're not continually having pain escalate, going up and down. We want that family member, first of all, to be comfortable. That is our number one goal. So just to know that those conversations happen, and hospice has certainly experienced them and will help you deal with that. Most caregivers and some patients are afraid of pain medications. Obviously, the words morphine and oxycodone, which we just heard our chief of police speak about, are very scary for people to even talk about, especially to administer. So we in our society think about that as drug abuse, overdose, or we're going to accelerate the dying process. That is not true. Most people who are given pain medications and are comfortable live longer. That's the studies. If you're going through pain and you're going through a lot of symptoms at the end of life, you are going to die quicker because you're putting more stress on your organs and you're just fighting, you know, to try to be comfortable. So it is important to work with your hospice nurse for pain medications. And the goal is to keep your loved one as alert as possible and pain-free. That's the goal. So he or she will work with you on that. Nothing is more exhausting than being in pain. So we always say that to families. You know, as much as you're worried about giving that morphine, think about what this patient's experiencing, because it is really, really important to keep someone as comfortable as possible. How do I know my loved one is okay with dying? That conversation should be happening all the time. And we have families who say, I just don't know how they feel. I don't know if they're afraid. I don't know if there's something else they want to say or do or see. So it's important at that time of life, and as a society, we have a hard time to try to break through that and have those conversations, because that's what gives the patient peace and the family peace. A lot of times, and we do see this in hospice care, we'll have a patient who's just sort of lingering and not going, and we'll talk to the family and say, is there anyone else that you think they want to see or anything else they want to say? And often they'll say, yes, you know what, they had an unreconciled situation with a son or a daughter. And we really try to help that make it happen, because often there needs to be closure in life. There needs to be a peaceful time. That doesn't always happen. We can't promise we're going to have it, but that's something we really think about. It's not just the physical, it's also the mental and the emotional and the spiritual support that we're going to give you, so that many of those issues can be resolved. Will someone be with me when my loved one dies? That's individualized. You can decide that if you want to be there. Some families just want to have a spouse, wants to be with their spouse alone. Often they do want to bring in other supports, and sometimes they want to volunteer to sit there. At the hospital, they have the No One Dies Alone program, so that if you want to go home and get some rest and you've got a patient who's imminent, there are volunteers who will sit there all night long and just be with your loved one so they aren't by themselves. We support you after the death of your loved one. And often this is kind of missed or overlooked, but our bereavement services program is excellent. We have bereavement staff and social workers who specialize in grief and the grief process. And they help you to understand that it's slow. Healing is a slow process, and you have to take the time. And they offer one-on-one counseling. They offer information that you can read, and you can just sort of take your time understanding what you're sort of going through, because it's obviously just like what you've just been taking care of a loved one. Now you're grieving, and that's a whole new experience in and of itself. And they teach you how to be gentle, and they offer supports, even just men's breakfast or coffees, women's walk and talks. It's amazing what's out there for you through the Doylestown Hospital Bereavement Services to help you as you're going through a grieving process. And that's it. We consider hospice a different way of caring. I like to say to people, you're still receiving care. It just looks different. Any questions?
Modern surgical practice is such that if you have a very, very severe surgical procedure, they will often put a catheter into the spine, and then they'll hook it up to a bag with morphine in it, and the patient has a little button he pushes.
Right.
And the pain gets difficult. Do they use that in hospice care?
We do not. Some hospices do, and I'll tell you why. As a person becomes really in a lot of pain, the beauty of a PCA pump is that when you're able to use that, you can push that button. when you're in hospice care and your disease progresses, you don't know exactly when to push that button. Cognitively, that's just difficult to do. So we've found through many years that the best pain medications are liquid morphine or pills, things like that, that can keep you comfortable rather than having extra equipment, let's say. We consider hospice care in Doylestown Hospital Hospice the simplest care so that families can be there for you. There's no fear of that catheter falling out. We manage our patients in a very simple, straightforward, but very effective way.
The other thing is that you mentioned in your talk that the most important consideration is the wishes of the patient. Mm-hmm. Now, do you feel that there should be a legal document very similar to a living will that's issued?
I think that's all right.
Where there is a directive by the patient stating this is how he wants his hospice care taken care of, rather than having the family impose it on the individual.
I think that's an interesting question, because obviously family dynamics work differently in each and every family. Optimal, the best solution would be to have everything in writing and to have that documentation so that a family, A, feels very comfortable with their decision. That's why we sort of have these talks, so that you can talk to your loved ones and they know what to do for you. I've been a nurse for a long time. I would say to you that there have been a very, very, I can only think of two occasions where I felt a family made that decision and were a little, I was a little unsure whether those wishes would have been met. Because families usually know that loved one well enough to be able to make that decision for them. And usually by the time you get to end of life and you're in a hospital situation and things just aren't working for you, things aren't helping or improving the situation, it's very difficult at that point to see someone go through that extensive treatment and care that occurs. Because it's not so gentle. It's not a gentle way to pass. It's not always a natural way to die. So that being said, the best case scenario is yes, there's documentation, paperwork, legal documents that tell your family what to do. Is that always there? No. So should there be a conversation? Yes. And should families reach an agreement and feel good about that? Absolutely. So.
One thing I say as an attorney who prepares these documents to my clients is when I do the healthcare power of attorney and living will, I say more important, in my opinion, than actually having these documents is to have a conversation with your family about your wishes. And I would suggest that maybe as part of those conversations at that time, this is a good way to spur the conversation, is to talk about hospice so that your family does know what your views are towards hospice. And I think that really would be the appropriate setting to do it, because everything's being laid out on the table.
That's correct. It's hard to get to that point. I think what happens is if there's an event that occurs suddenly, that's when families panic, because they're just not sure, you know, what to do, and maybe that discussion hasn't taken place. So you're absolutely right. If you're able to have that conversation before the crisis, that's perfect. But there are times that doesn't happen, so families need to have some kind of idea of what you would want to happen. My husband calls me like morbid Melody, because I always say to him, now, if this happens, what would you want to do? But you know what? I need to know. I need to know whether he would want to be intubated on a ventilator and for how long. And if there were no, you know, if it seemed hopeless, how long would he want me to keep trying? Does he want a feeding tube? Would he want to even, sometimes the question is, be on thickened liquids and pureed foods? Some people say, you know what? I don't want to live like that. So there are limits, you know, as to how you want to live your life and the quality of life you want to have. Those conversations need to happen, and even though they're sometimes uncomfortable.
You talk about bereavement services being available for hospice care. What about if you had a loved one die, not in hospice care?
You still have that option.
Bereavement services are available.
Absolutely. Through Doylestown Hospital, the bereavement services that we provide are also available to the community. In fact, a lot of our families are from the community. There's a newsletter that goes out. If you get on the Doylestown Hospital website and go to bereavement, it will point you in that direction, and the whole list of activities is posted there. Any other questions? Yes.
You mentioned it real quickly, and I sort of happy to miss it. Cost. everything's being paid by Medicare?
Medicare is covering the cost of medications to keep the patient comfortable, durable equipment like hospital beds, those sorts of things. It's paying for the hospice care. If you need caregiving above and beyond that, like if you need to go into a facility, then you're responsible for the room and board. You're responsible for adjunct therapies that you might want to have that hospice maybe didn't. By that I'm saying, sometimes physicians will say we want to do these herbal medicines and those sort of things. The hospice Medicare doesn't cover those. They cover almost everything though, but not caregiving. So if you have supportive caregiving, like 24-hour caregiving in the home, that's privately paid.
And we had a friend of ours, single woman, whose mother, she's a little older than me, I'm 80 already, she's 83, and she had to go to work. She couldn't take care of her. Mm-hmm. And she put her in a nursing home. Would any of this hospice stuff cover the nursing home?
Not the room and board, but the care in the nursing home. What we would have probably talked about with that friend of yours is how to provide maybe some caregiving, which would have, like I said before, been less expensive in the home while she worked. And also volunteers that could come in and stay. Let's say she only had to work, you know, a few hours a day, or she needed to work in her home, then volunteers could also come and help.
So what would you recommend if somebody gets she would stay at home under hospice care and it wouldn't cost anything, right? Because she's under Medicare?
It would only cost if you had to have other caregivers
right,
in the
I
home.
Understand.
Right.
And somebody would come in during the day, every day, to check up on her while this woman's at work?
What we could do, they wouldn't stay with her. We wouldn't be all there right. to be the 24-hour supervision at all. So we would help her with resources in the community and other ways to get that.
Okay.
But no, that's a very good question, because we get asked that. Can you just come and stay with my mom all day, or can you come spend the night? Hospice under the Medicare benefit does not provide custodial care. We're not even allowed to do that by Medicare regulations. Medicare is only paying us to do what we're allowed to do.
Thank you.
Yes.
When my father was close to the end, we had hospice and we had a 24-hour aide. Mm-hmm. Hospice brought in morphine plus hospital bed and mm-hmm. the like, and the aide absolutely refused to administer any morphine. She said she'd been at this for a long time and morphine was to kill the patient. Mm-hmm. She wouldn't administer it. Is that common, and what do you do?
Not very common, not anymore. Most people are educated and understand the use of morphine. And quite frankly, most caregivers, even for agencies, now are screened. And they need to understand that the plan of care that's in place is not there. It's not driven by them. They're not the one in the driver's seat. The plan of care is driven by the patient, the family, the physician, and the hospice team. They're there to under that direction. So that probably should have been emphasized. Any other questions?
Thank you very much. It was an excellent program.
Thank you very much.